today there will be two different happenings that I'll share with you. They are also from my grandmother. One happened when she was not married, and the second one happened at after she was married, and she came to my grandfather's house. These are really late 19th, early 20th century. A lot of things which we take for granted nowadays, like electricity and availability of certain things, was not there. So the first story happened to my grandmother's aunt. She came from a biggish family. Her father and father's family were zamindars in a place called Rongpur, which is now in East Bengal, or rather what we know as Bangladesh. They had a few villages which belonged to them, and they were the zamindars of that place. They used to stay in a village called Chandpur. My grandmother's father had brothers and otherwise. It was like a joint family, erstwhile joint family, like it used to be. A lot of different relatives were also there. People used to work there. There was nothing like a parda, but obviously the section where the women used to work and the section where men used to work were different. So the house was divided into two parts, you can say. One part was for where men used to work, like the office kind of a thing was there, and where they used to greet other people. And then there was a part which was the interior of the house, where certain outsiders were not allowed. The interior side of the house was the kitchen, and during this time, most houses came with kitchen garden, they came with a well, they came with ponds, they came with certain other smaller houses where the household help used to stay. In those days, the facilities for the washrooms were never inside the house. Washrooms were always outside. They were washrooms, but they were always outside the house. There was a pathway into the village. Like, the women not necessarily had to go through the front door, they could go from, you can say, behind the house into the village. Like, they needed to go to the village for whatever they needed. Go and meet somebody, go to the mandir, whatever. The population was a mixture. There was Hindus and there were Muslims. And they were what you call dargahs in the village. And the dargahs mostly were in places which are a little remote, like in a little land which is in the forest, not the cultivable land, but the forest land. Those places made very good shortcuts for people to come in, and most women used to do that. They used to go out into the village and then just run back through there. The children used to play there. It was like a walk path. Now my grandmother's aunt, this was the younger uncle's wife. Again, she was a young person. She used to have a lot of friends in the village. She used to go there and move around. How we make friends today, what we have as, let's say, a Facebook or any other medium, how we make friends, all of that were not always obviously available to them. So they had something called shoi. Shoi means friend. So they used to make friends, like in the village, let's say, women used to get married at a pretty young age. So an 8 or a 9 year old would make a friend with another 8 or a 9 year old, and they used to call each other shoi, as in friend. This aunt had a few shois in the village, and she used to go to spend time with them.
So at this point of time, how old was this aunt?
She was around 18 or 19 years old.
Okay, and I'm like in a teenagers to early 20s.
Early 20s. So one day, like normal, she had gone out to meet her friend or friends, and she came back and everything was fine. But from late evening, she started feeling a little sick, as in she threw up, and her whole body, she said that it was feeling very heavy. It's like as if she's got fever, she's feeling very tired. The women of the house, they said that okay, might have caught a cold. Next day morning, she woke up. It was like the aunt kind of started changing as a person.
Like personality changes in her?
Yeah, I mean, first thing, they kept calling her name, she wouldn't respond. like every day she sat down to eat with everybody, and the way she started eating was very different than how anybody does eat. And you know, she started the rice was thrown on all sides of the plate, and you will understand this is sitting on the ground and eating, so there are no tables that they are having, they're sitting on the ground. She threw rice and she started eating with both her hands, and the person who was sitting next to her said, what are you doing? And I'm talking you know, late 19th century, so they are like, why are you using your left hand? No, that's a dirty hand. Don't use that hand. So she didn't say anything. She really did not eat. She just toyed with her food and got up. In the evening, she really felt sick. Like, she had a very high fever. She was absolutely restless. People could see that she was in some kind of a pain, but they couldn't understand what kind of a pain. Till then, the ladies of the house hadn't told the elders, like the male elders of the house, that she was unwell. But as they saw the night progressing, she was really getting out of control. They had to kind of you know, talk to the head of the family and say, like, we really need to call the doctor who's there in the village.
So was there any reason why they didn't tell before that she's not feeling well to the elders of the house, like,
or... So they were elder women also of the house. It was just not elder men. So a lot of time for children and for women, a lot of home remedies worked, right? So if you have fever or if you have cold and cough, you really did not go to the doctor. Or even if the, you know, whatever womanly problems they had, they would talk to the women. It was much more, it was easy to talk to women. They could really explain their problems to them. A question might arise here that as she was married, what happened to her husband?
Yeah.
So to explain to you, she was being nurtured in the house as a girl. She wasn't really living with her husband all the time. And there were times when she had more friends with people in the house and she wanted to stay with them or sleep with them, like other girls, or you know, the girls who were growing up, the daughters of the family, she was free to do that. It's not that she had to go and stay with her husband all the time. And a lot of time the husbands were out, because I told you they had a zamindari of a few villages, so they used to go for rounds, they used to do their own stuff. So the doctor comes, or the Kabiraj as they say in the village, he comes and he checks her and he says that he feels that she's having a fit. That's what he understood. He gave some medicines. He said that she's having high fever. Cool her feet, cool her hands, cool her forehead, like we do when people have high fever. Wash her hair, without washing all the hair, just wash her head so the fever comes down. By morning, her fever had settled. Okay. By afternoon, she was feeling okay. You know, she was kind of, they thought she was kind of getting better. She was actually better. She didn't have fever. She did not have any signs of fit or something. But she changed as a person. So she told everybody that she doesn't want to sit down and eat with them. She had this enormous desire to eat non-vegetarian food. At this point of time in Bengal, fish is allowed. Fish is cooked pretty much on a daily basis because it's a fish-centric, river-centric place. Mutton was never had. Mutton was something that was introduced pretty much after independence. Chicken, men used to eat chicken, but it was cooked outside the house. She never had meat. She had fish and rest of the stuff that was there, but nothing like chicken or something like that. And she said she wanted to have chicken, so they said, they thought, oh wow, but we don't cook inside the house. She said, then I'll go outside and eat. Then they got a little alarmed, like, you know, she's the bahu of the family, she's like a daughter, she's grown up there with so many people. They were a little worried, why is she talking like this? So they tried to explain to her and said, oh, I think you had fever, so maybe you want to eat something, maybe, you know, the taste in your mouth has to change. Let's go and have Imli chutney. She said, no, I don't want chutney. I want to have chicken. So anyway, so they tried to kind of, you know, keep her at bay and all of them. But in their minds, in their hearts, they were getting really worried. in this scenario, please understand that in the interior of the house where cooking is going on and everything is going on and women are generally there, there are a lot of women from the village who used to come in to work sometimes and generally spend time or to come to meet the elders of the house or something like that. So there is a constant stream of people who are coming and going. So they started also kind of asking questions. They also were very concerned, like they've seen her for the last whatever number of years. They were like, what is wrong with her? In all of this discussion, somebody said, oh, yesterday I saw her coming back from the backfield. Did she go to the Pirsthan? So the head of the women, the mother-in-law, the grandmother-in-law, I don't know who, said, what? No. So then this lady said, no, I saw her coming from there. You ask her if she did come from there. So they said, okay. They called her and they told her that, hey, yesterday, where did you come back from? Where did you come back from? So she said, I came back from there. And that place, like the road leads into that, where the Peer Darga was. So there were two dargahs, two kind of peers there. And she walked in between them. Okay. So obviously when you're walking in between two of these kind of things, you are touching them. And she was running back because she had got delayed. And somehow they understood that something happened there. What happened, nobody knew. Now the women were in a little bit of a worry that has something come from there, because she's behaving really weird. Really, she doesn't behave like that. But they said, okay, maybe we are thinking too much. Let's see it for a minute. The doubt had come in their mind, but they did not react to it or do anything. Another 2-3 day passes with her behaving sometimes odd, sometimes okay. Sometimes she's completely normal. Like sometimes she's like the old person that she is, and sometimes she behaves like really weirdly. And 4-5 days passes. Then one night, and they did not know this. This is after the fact. She was out of her house, out of the house, out of the room. And this time she was, her husband had come back, so she was with her husband. So he got up in the morning and he couldn't find her. She was nowhere around. And they went on looking in that entire house, that where is she, where is she, where is she, where is she? And then they found her in the well. She was in the well. She had somehow got inside the well, which was a deep well. And she was standing, rather she was floating in the well. She wasn't touching the walls of the well. Her hands were on her, in her side. And she was standing right upright in that water with only her nose and eyes to be seen, and her hair was fanning all across. Some of the women fainted just looking at her like that. Her eyes were kind of open, but she wasn't looking at anything. It was impossible for her feet to touch the, you know, the
base
of the well, because it is so deep. You could understand, the well is so deep. And she was there. She was just floating there. Her entire hair was around, like floating on the water. Obviously, they had to bring her up. So again, 2-3 people kind of, went inside and brought her out. She was completely wet. And they realized that she was there for a few hours. They don't know what time, but she was there for a few hours. She had no sense. And you know how they understood that she was in water for such a long time? Because if you're in water for a long time, it's like your skin kind of contracts.
It becomes pruny.
Yeah, it becomes very pruny. So her fingertips, her feet, her toes and had become pruny. Anyway, they changed her. They put her in, put her in warm clothes. Everybody started crying because it was scary. It was sad all at the same time. They were like out of options. They had no idea what to do. And this kind of started happening pretty much on a regular nightly basis. She would jump into the well. And people saw it. Like at a given point of time in the night, post 12 o'clock, she would just walk out of her room and just jump into the well. and stay like that. It was a very sad situation. In all of this, there was a fakir who was known in the village, and somebody told him, so he came and he checked her out, and he said that I think that she walked in the peer's dargah, and you know, she must have by mistake touched it, or you know, somehow her feet might have touched the dargah or something like that, and she's carried something back with her. He said that as I understand, she's just going to go from bad to worse. At some point of time, we will not be able to keep her. So they all said that, hey, please tell us how to do it. We are calling doctors and things like that. Her husband and her, you know, the other people in the house still wanted to take her and get her checked and things like that. But the women of the house said, no, hold on. I know a lot of you don't believe in this and all of that, but let us try. If we don't succeed, you are free to do everything. So he said, okay, every day you will light diya and ghee diya in front of the room that she is, and you have to make sure she doesn't get out of the room. So they said, okay. They started lighting that diya. When they started lighting that diya, from that, she really fought with people, but she couldn't get out of the house. And post that time, whatever the Cinderella hour was when she used to jump into the well, she became quiet by herself. It was, she didn't have that, there was like this rush of energy between a particular time period when she used to go crazy and wanted to jump into the well. So what happened was, because she was not jumping into the well and they did not let her go out and all of that, she was a little better. And then 3 days into this, the fakir came back very hurriedly one day and said, look, I'm sorry, but today is a very important day. Today, by no means she should get out of the house, because if she does, it is out of my hands and your hands also. So they decided that, okay, let's not put this task to the men. We will stay with her. My grandmother's mother and another aunt, they stayed with her at night. And they have described that night, she was violent. She was violent. She was literally violent. Like, they had scratches and marks and bites on their body from her. The desire to get out of that room, she became scary. Like, she would bark. Really like a monster. Her hair was open, and she would open all her clothes, and she would scratch herself, and then she would come and bite them, beat them up, and she became like a total monster. It was so scary, like, but they held on to her.
I must say, the women in your family seem very brave to have like been there that night when she's gone so out of control. Whatever that thing was, I'm assuming had taken full charge of her body at that point of time.
There was a lot of I like to believe, because we hear a lot of things to the contrary nowadays, but I do believe that women were very empowered, or rather they have been very empowered, and there was a lot of love and a lot of affection for this person. They took it personally. They said, we'll not let that thing win, whatever that thing is. It was a night I don't think they ever forgot, because by the time things cooled down and, you know, everything became shant, thanda, whatever, my grandmother's mother and her and the other aunt, they were battle-worn. They were completely battle-worn. So you see, there is something called a physical injury that is happening. There is also an emotional injury, like the amount of emotions that has been required to keep her in that room, like shouting and screaming and obviously she was violent both physically and verbally. You know, her speech had become garbled, but she was saying some really bad things about them, you know. And she started saying things about them like, oh, you are so good friends with each other. Do you know what did she say about you on that day?
So things she could not have known.
Yeah, she thinks she could not have known. And thoughts she could not have known. So she was trying to drive a wedge between these two women, because, you know,
she wanted to get out of the room.
The thing wanted to get out of the room. She did not. thing wanted to get out of the room. And the women stuck on. And they said, nothing doing. We can be worst of friends and best of enemies later on, but at this time, this is our job, is to keep this thing or keep her inside the room. Morning came, people of the house came back. They did hear the shouting and screaming, but they were too scared to approach. And they were asked not to also. The aunt who was possessed, like she fell asleep. She slept straight for two, three days. When she woke up from her, whatever the kind of sleep that they did not disturb her. They just fed her time to time to make sure that she was okay. She was perfectly normal. She didn't remember anything. Not a single thing she remembered. Her memory stopped when she was coming back home, you know, walking across the field, and it came back on the day she woke up. It was about 20 odd days. She didn't remember anything. She kind of asked people that, why am I here? What am I doing? What is wrong? Why are you guys so worried about me? It is like you got hit on the head and you went into whatever zone, and then you woke up, and generally people ask, in Hindi movies you get to see ki main kahan hoon. It was almost like that for her.
And did they call the fakir back?
He never came back. He said the work will be done. So he never came back to them. Like, he never even came to say that give me money or something like that. He never came back. Strangely.
And what about her bruises at that point of time? Like you said,
she had no idea why she had scratches all over her body. Like, she had scratched herself. And then she had hurt herself so many times just walking into the well. So she did hit herself, right? She was walking like a blind person into the well. So she did hit herself. So she said, what happened? So they kind of tried to explain as much as they can. And she couldn't believe it. This is not something that happened. I said, 20 days. She said, 20 days. I woke up after 20 days. He said, no, you were awake. You were only asleep for about two and a half days. She said, no, I don't remember anything. I just was walking back yesterday from my friend's house. But thankfully, she went on to have children and settle down. And you know, I have met her.
Okay.
When I was very young, I used to love her because she obviously did not tell me this story. My grandmother did. I had this privilege of meeting my great grand aunt and great grandmother, and you know, I had the privilege of meeting them for a few years, but I did. And she used to call me Mona Lisa because she thought my smile was like that. And she was such a nice person, I can't tell you, Ishank. It's like I could never believe this story because she was somebody who was so loving, so giving, so caring, and so funny. The reason all the children used to love her is because she was so very funny. She used to make fun of everything and really good cook. But that's what happened to her. So I don't know what to believe or not to believe, but that's my story. I hope people have liked hearing this story.
Well, I'm sure they will. Honestly, as you were narrating this incident, I was getting chills, literal chills, just thinking about how your family would have reacted finding her in the well.
Yeah.
Especially that part is going to stay with me.
It's very scary.
And I'm consciously not going to think about it, especially in the night when I'm walking alone.
I consciously don't think about it. It's like every time you picture it in your head, right? That's a little scary. And I also wanted to tell people, because we are saying this kind of stories which have certain religious connotations. It also has certain cultural connotations. It's like your belief. You want to believe it, you believe it. We are just narrating stories which we've heard. I personally think my grandmother was very honest when she told this story. She saw it as a girl, and when she told me, she was my grandmother. So she had traveled that many years in life. So I just want the listeners to understand. But we are just sharing our experiences.
Yeah, I mean, it's up to the listeners. You can listen to it like a story, a scary story. Believe it as an experience, or we leave it up to you how you want to decipher it.
We just expect you not to think about the woman in the well.